meeting is being recorded for RCTV Live, Comcast Channel 22, or Verizon Channel 33 on Verizon.
We can only hear that if you're tuned in.
Yeah.
That's the funny part, isn't it?
Yeah, you're going to figure that out.
Well, let's go watch.
Before we do that, let's go through our agenda. So, tonight's agenda, a few things. One is that at our last meeting, we had a discussion about changing the FinCom recommended reserve policy, and we kind of had, by a show of hands or nodding heads, that we wanted to adjust it. We gave that indication back, I think, to Bob and to Sharon, to share with the selectmen also. And one of the things we thought we would do is kind of have another discussion about that, see if there are any other questions or comments. And then vote if you want to change it to what we had recommended, which probably is what we should do. Second on the agenda, I think it would be good for Bob to go through a couple of things. It said here discussion on the budget, but last night's selectmen meeting, there were three topics that came up, and it's probably worth reviewing a little bit because two of the items will be on the warrant to be voted on by town meeting, and that relates to senior relief. I guess I'll call it a related item in terms of how it would be paid for. And the selectmen voted last night 5-0 to support
the concept of senior tax relief.
Right.
And hold a special town meeting and an indicated special election in October. So September 12th, October 18th, town meeting and election.
And I apologize, I'm guilty of moving forward too quickly. I want to introduce our newest member. So Eric Burkhart has joined us. Craig, I guess, has retired from FinCom. Eric joins us. Let me let you kind of give a quick background, who you are and why you're here.
Sure. Eric Burkhart, 5-plus-year Reading resident. Two kids at Killam. Involved in the town coaching, that type of thing. Went up against Coach McNeese a couple times. I think we lost them both.
Yeah.
Well, I still think you had eighth graders as ringers.
Don't tell anyone. Gotta win some.
Let's see. First got interested in town government. My first exposure to town government was the firearms issue as one of the petitioners and got an interesting first taste of town meeting. But thought it was interesting and became a town meeting member since. Got interested in the municipal finance side, had attended a finance forum, and I think one of these meetings as the override discussion started to really kind of pick up, and then became involved with the Yes for Reading group, which is an advocacy group for the override. But my role with Yes was primarily, I was on the steering committee, but it was objective, right? The leadership of Yes, and I agreed strongly, was they were in favor of just getting the facts out, just trying to get the story out and create awareness. We weren't really advocating, we were just trying to get the story out. And so my role was to, for our website, write the overview and the FAQ. And so subsequently, I bothered Sharon and Bob quite a bit trying to collect all this information and try to figure this stuff out. So while it was an advocacy group, I can't remember ever once trying to convince somebody to vote for an override. I saw my role as just trying to get the story out, and so I encourage you to read the FAQ. It's kind of evidence of that. And then when I saw the opening on FinCom, I'm much more interested in the longer term kind of financial issues of the town, and so resigned from the Yes group with the interest of joining here. So thank the selection committee, which was Mark and John Halsey and Alan Fultz, for giving me the chance.
Welcome. We're glad to have you with us. We have, for the last year or so, I think, had kind of a full group of nine, which is great because for a long time it was harder to get the full nine. And I think there's enough activity in the town right now and a lot of very interested people wanting to participate. It's really nice to see. So we welcome you with open arms. Sorry, now we'll come back to the agenda. So, reserve policy. So the FinCom's role, as we know, and Eric, you've kind of seen some of these things also, we're advisory to town meeting, we get involved in all financial issues kind of affecting the town and in those areas. And one of the things that we have done is to set a few policies in terms of recommendations that we try to stick to in terms of reserve policy. We have kind of an unofficial policy in terms of how much capital might be allowed in the operating budget, which is allocated toward capital. We don't have an official policy on OPEB at this point, but it's something that we've had some discussions about, and OPEB isn't going away, so it's something we're going to need to continue to talk about and perhaps have some policy recommendations there as well. But the reserve policy, I think, is the kind of the longest standing, perhaps.
Yeah, it's 10 years, and there was one before it. There was at least another 10 years. There's been something for 20 plus years.
Great. And the policy has been that we would hold 5% essentially of the budget in reserve accounts. And reserve accounts could be free cash. They could also be, I don't get through the entire list, but we have some stabilization funds that also, in some cases, have a little bit of encumbrance on them. But they're essentially not fully encumbered and could be used for different types of activities. In cases where the town, in fact, before a previous override, dug very deep into those reserves, much deeper than anybody had hoped, I think. But that's one of the reasons why they're there. It is something of a balancing an emergency kind of fund. What we've learned a little bit, and I'll let Bob talk about this, is that the ratings agencies, when we go out and borrow money, they prefer to see that you have some cash in the bank also. And one of their criteria for kind of offering us low rates. You know, I don't know that having the lowest rate is the, adding, you know, X million dollars might not be the right reason to go forward with that. We don't borrow money that frequently. But it's lovely to have really low rates and to have a better rating than the state, I believe, right? So that's kind of where we are. So the policy had been sitting at 5. What we have seen is that our reserve balances actually have been growing over the last 3 to 4 years in particular. And they're up toward kind of this 9-10% range right now in terms of what we have. Partially because of some conservative assumptions, partially because we have regenerated more cash than we ever anticipated we would be. But in any event, the numbers have been kind of going up. As we look at the other towns that neighbor us or are we consider to be similar towns, one of the questions that was brought up at a previous meeting was, do they have, you know, lower balances, higher balances, where should we be? I think Bob answered this, that, you know, other folks are seeming to be in these higher ranges. At the audit committee, we brought it up and asked the auditor about the communities that they look at and what kind of reserve balances are they holding and where are they now. And the auditor kind of responded, they're all kind of growing a bit right now. So that led to some discussion that we've had over the last year or so. I think that came up to the selectmen. I think it came up also that Sharon and Bob had a discussion also saying, hey, maybe we should be looking at a different position. Last meeting, I believe, we talked about going to, I think, a 7% number. So why don't I open it to questions and comments from there? If anybody has any.
Yeah, the towns are in the high single digits, roughly, I guess, as we are.
We looked at a few different towns, and we saw, you know, different towns have different policies. They have some flexible kinds of numbers in some cases, but the numbers seem to be, they're all higher than 5, the ones that have them. And they kind of allocate different ways. I think we have kind of two things to talk about. One is the absolute number, and that's kind of in the policy. The other is what funds we hold, how do we hold them? You know, stabilization funds, are they quote unquote free cash? Where do they sit, where do they reside? And I don't think we're prepared to have that discussion now, although I know there are some recommendations here that we can discuss about what may happen in the case of an override.
Oh, yeah.
So, you know, my suggestion would be to kind of focus first on the level, and then we can separately start talking about what those funds are, how they can be used, and any other questions we may have.
Shouldn't we talk about a range with at least 7 and up to a...
Yeah, we got a little hung up on the wording is kind of where we left off last time.
Yeah, but I think 7 was our.
Yeah.
I thought we decided the range. As a group,
right,
we sort of didn't
yeah.
love the idea of a
range. The range,
but right.
Right.
We decided
the end. I think we're getting caught up in the upper mountain, and I don't think that should be our concern.
Right.
Right.
It's not
right.
Really
right.
Concern.
Right.
So did we leave it at the language was a set level?
I think so.
That's what
that's
what I remember.
A floor.
Yeah, above a floor.
Yeah.
I think that the wording was that it would be a minimum of 7%,
mm-hmm.
but where it's an internal policy, you have that discretion to go below that for certain circumstances, and that 5% would be cause for concern if we were to fall to that level.
Mm-hmm.
So it kind of gave you a little bit of flexibility
mm-hmm.
between 5 and 7, but what we're striving for is a minimum of 7. I think that's
sounds
the
right.
way it was
yeah,
worded.
That sounds right.
Mm-hmm.
And it was just to give us some flexibility, because if we fell to 5, we would do some cutting back in the budget to try and get money back into the reserves and make some changes to try and get back to 7.
Yeah, clearly. I just like, we had that quick discussion, and then I'm very comfortable with those numbers.
I agree.
Can I
sure,
ask
please.
A question? And putting on devil's advocate hat for just 2 seconds, and I'm not saying I hold to this position, but just want to throw it out because I think it could be a frequently asked question. So I look at this and say, okay, FinCom is going from a 5% to a 7% reserve policy. At the same time, we're deliberating on whether or not we want to go and pass some level of an override. Shouldn't we be looking at keeping our reserve? Why are you at the same time asking for more money and keeping it more in the bank? I think that will be an FAQ.
Yep.
And just good to kind of have a response.
I think it's good business sense to have more reserves aside, just in general. But also, I think the Board of Selectmen did pass this fund balance policy because the auditors requested it. So I picked numbers and we talked about FinCom and the Board of Selectmen approved it as well. I don't think we're pushing it very high. I mean, I think that the bond rating agencies like to see it higher than 7. The 7 is our baseline. So I don't think we're pushing it to an extreme level.
No, I think we're going with, 7 is a modest increase. It shows we're pushing in the right direction. I hope it does come up as a, frequently asked question, because I think we're coming from the right angle. We're saying that, look, if we're going out to the town, and I don't want to get ahead of anything, but if that's the path you go down, we're going out to the town for more money, we need to show them that that additional money, those funds are going to be dealt with appropriately, they're going to be handled correctly, and that we have a long-term view, and that we're not going out to do this for purely a short-term solution. Great, bring the money in, it's going to be spent, and let's move on. We need to show everyone that, this is a well-thought-out plan. This is where we should be. There are multiple reasons why we need this money. 5%, when we're looking at things like health insurance and the rates that those are increasing, 5% was probably too low to begin with, and now it's clearly inadequate.
That's
awesome.
Yeah, I think it's a great question.
That was a question that I think might... why are we saving more when you're asking more? That's kind of just...
No, I think, it's a
good question. I feel sort of the opposite. All the more reason why you get up more in reserves. Because I understand it's an internal policy. You may have to rely on going below your policy, and I think that makes the argument stronger.
I'm assuming it's unrelated, right? It's something that FinCom has a responsibility to think about regardless of what's going on in the town. From an override perspective,
right.
This is us doing our job independently, in the best interest of the town. So that's how I personally feel that.
It may help us explain the difference between kind of annual operating needs, which every year you need, this amount and it grows, and this pool of money that's sitting there that's more kind of one time. So that, if you took $1 million from here, put it to the operating budget, you'd have to find a way to replenish that year over year after that. So it kind of means next year you need another, and the next year you need another. So it really, maybe it's a good way to help distinguish for people kind of what, why that is. Whatever the number is, 5%, 7%, it's a big number right now. It's north of $5 million, right? It's between 5 and 10. And I think it's fair, everybody should look at it and say, what's it there for? What are we concerned about? We know that we have fluctuations in the snow and ice budget that can be from zero money coming back to, what was the biggest one ever? Certainly 500,000-600,000.
$1.5 million.
Oh, $1.5 million.
Thank you.
2 years ago, it was over $1 million.
Yeah. So there are some big things that can happen. And we have some uncertainty still going on. So
what I'm hearing is, and apologies because I missed the last conversation, but the rationale here is more, we feel that the 5%, while that's been our target, has been too low. And it's the prudent thing to do to raise it. An ancillary reason could be the auditors like to see that and so on and so forth, but the main reason is
yes, and we've had these discussions starting at least 2 years ago about let's take another look at the percent of reserves that we're holding.
While the 5 was low, we've consistently been above the 5. Yeah, the policy was low,
sure.
But in practice,
right,
not to set off alarms.
So should we, and I don't have it with me, but maybe we can find it online, should we take a look at what the existing document is and change it to accommodate both the 7% and the notion of 5 being a cause for concern, rather than kind of rewriting it from scratch?
Do we want the 5% being cause for concern in an actual policy?
Personally, I'd say no.
Yeah. Because I would just say why.
Well,
so
otherwise, they suggest that below 7 is cause for concern.
I sort of liked it. I like being in line with what we just published.
Then we're saying that we're in trouble if we're below 7.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, maybe not panic trouble, but
right.
Yeah.
Yes, varying levels of trouble.
Right.
That's what's going on.
I'm
not against
below 7. You're kind of
maybe we could leave
it
like
that.
Yeah, sliding scale.
Oh,
right.
So we probably should kind of find what the old policy was and change it that way, unless we want to just word some of the brand.
Can we get it printed out for you?
Yeah.
Do you have it? That'd be great.
You want the FinCom one or the fund balance one that I showed?
FinCom.
Okay. Yep.
Should we also get our hands on the one that we did last?
Yeah.
To get up.
Thank you.
Just
because
it's confirmed without the word.
So why don't we defer that just for a moment? One thing we do need is we need someone to act as liaison to the facilities department, so poor Joe Huggins doesn't feel left alone. So on page 12, everyone except Eric kind of voted on what they were going to take care of this, right?
I thought we gave Eric everything.
Yeah,
I heard
we cut back. Actually, you were watching it, weren't you, Eric? I think
I,
as we were
I,
doing
I saw some of it. I do remember at one point someone said, "Welcome to FinCom." I went like this to the screen.
That sounds
clever.
Doors locked. My key.
I have a key
in my purse. Didn't realize she not left. So
probably it'd be nice to spend a good amount of time with Joe, right? Since he's involved in lots of activities.
I don't know, honestly. Space needs, yes. Current situation of buildings, not so much.
Right.
It makes sense to me that someone involved in the permanent building committee, parentheses Eric, would work with facilities. I mean, that's the closest. Oh yeah, Eric. That's really the closest tie.
So, if that would be interesting to you, Eric, maybe you could trade something else.
Or if you don't want that, I'm comfortable with the facilities.
No, I'm happy to take it. Is anyone interested in finance or public safety? Or I mean, I'm happy to.
I'll take finance.
Happy to do it, though.
I'll take finance. That's
happy to do all four.
That's all.
Okay.
Okay, great.
I have to rearrange your schedule now.
Exactly. I did it 2 years ago and they never called me, so.
I never went to DEF CON 4.
Yeah. Great.
You guys did free cash, and I should have asked Sharon this before she left. You definitely had shown a good chart at one point, showing each year what we put in the budget in order to balance it and what was regenerated. The bars were good, you know, like,
yeah.
I thought it was good at demonstrating that although we rely on balanced budget, in reality it's sort of
Yeah, there's always the discussion that, that she and I have and then you guys get involved with is what is a natural regeneration assumption that's sensible but slightly conservative. Over the years, I think it's kind of evolved from half a million to closer to a million. 750, a million, whatever it is. And then some years, there's a million of revenue higher and a million of expenses we don't spend, and it's 2 million. And that's why our free cash has grown.
Right, and we've put it all under that umbrella of regeneration, which I don't think it gives the impression that we're regenerating funds. Well, no, it's giving back money that we didn't spend and overestimating.
That's just the accounting term, though.
Yeah,
but
I think...
Just like free cash, it might be misleading.
You know, especially a lot of time meeting members are probably thinking, wow, what do we have this invested in?
What do they do up there?
It's a printing press.
But you did definitely, actually, the last time meeting, I think you took some time to explain what that was, and I thought that was very worthwhile. Because I think it's unclear to a lot of people what regeneration means. So I think we've got to keep that education going.
And I don't know if Sharon knows, but that's an example of something. I have no idea what other towns do in regeneration. If they do a lot more than us, a lot less than us.
Mm-hmm.
I couldn't imagine it's a lot more. But you know, some communities, when I did looked at our 25 peers for actual cash reserves position, as reported to the state, which isn't perfect. Some of the communities that I would have not considered a candidate to have a high balance did. So that's probably because of regeneration. There's not a lot of ways you get that. And then some communities spend regeneration, capital, OPEB, whatever some one-time thing is. And we've done some of that for sure, but not in the last couple of years generally. We haven't, because we're being a little more careful. But certainly until 10 years ago, when I got here as an employee, I don't remember free cash being used to balance a budget except in an emergency. So that whatever the assumptions were, one of them was not we will use free cash.
Mm-hmm. Right.
But I also think that...
But I also remember what the levels of free cash were at the time.
Well, I think that our expenses were under budget, and health insurance clearly was.
Mm-hmm.
And our revenue estimates were a little high. So there wasn't a tendency to regenerate quite as much. So it's kind of semantics. You relax your assumptions a little and make them more conservative, and then you use free cash, or you don't.
Mm-hmm.
Who cares? It sort of doesn't matter. I think from a revenue standpoint, and I know I can speak for Sharon, she's real comfortable the way we forecast revenues now. Only once in the last 10 years have revenues come in less. And coming in less is a really bad thing. That's worse than the other side. So
what do you mean by the other side?
Well,
expense.
If we have to go back to town meeting in April because we need another $500,000 or $1 million during the year, as long as you have it, that's okay. But having a revenue deficit, you got to explain it to the state, and you got to account for it. So,
even if the revenue deficit is from not enough local aid,
exactly.
Same.
Yeah. Most likely,
you're coming tomorrow, right?
Yeah, I'm planning on.
Yeah, all right.
Yeah. I'll be respectful.
So maybe what we should do is move ahead into
I can
pieces.
Take a whack at some of the easy stuff before we get into some of the harder stuff. And I've got a lot of stuff on here if you really want to get into detail. Let me first describe some of the things the selectmen did that will and will won't impact you. They called for a special town meeting. They didn't call for a special election, but they will call. They said they would. They can't do that legally just yet. They did ask town council to draw up, which he's doing right now, a home rule petition for senior tax relief. That will be the centerpiece, I would say, of the September town meeting. The September town meeting has 8 articles. The first 3 are boilerplate. We do have some capital changing around needs. We don't have to add any money, but we just have to reclassify some capital, and some of it you're aware of from the fire chief who couldn't be here tonight. He needs $1,000 on an ambulance for $275,000 we missed. And then he also is going to ask for some equipment. So he's going to ask for FinCom reserves in a month, the end of August, whenever he's got you scheduled. And then at the town meeting, before he can actually buy the equipment, the capital plan must change by vote at town meeting. And then in November, you can get your
reserves back. And the reason we can't use money in September is we could use stabilization funds, but we don't have free cash. It doesn't exist until the state says it does. So those three articles. Then there's three smaller senior tax exemption or tax relief articles that we had done a couple in the past, and it's been maybe 5 years, and we're updating them. We're changing one of the exemption amounts from 750 to 1,000, which until 3 days ago was the maximum. Now the state has just increased it again. And then the fourth senior tax relief article is this home rule petition. I suggest that, you know, it's not really a FinCom issue per se, but I'll just say that it could be a very complex topic, and we decided to make it as simple as possible. And in making it simple, it's not ideal for Reading. We're copying a state model. We're using state guidelines. And certainly what came across last night was, you know, state guidelines such as $60,000 to $80,000 minimum income or maximum income seem high for, you know, a senior. But the other piece of that is a senior over 65 with those income limits must also pay 10% or more of their property tax as a percent of their income. So if you're making 80 grand as a senior, your property taxes have to be more than 8 grand in order to qualify. So there is some kind of a limiting factor.
Sorry. This is the actual policy, and that's the policy. I make copies for everyone.
Just start sending them around.
Yep. And then also, you had sent this in your email when we were talking about it. There's actually some of the rates that others have. Winchester, Lexington, North Reading didn't have anything, but Stone.
Oh, thank you.
That was from one of the
emails. Yep. So it's really tax policy. It doesn't change the revenue. It doesn't change the tax. It just rearranges the obligation so that seniors will have some less amount of an obligation. And the selectmen through tax classification indicated that all the other classes of property would share in today's ratio of that expense.
And rough numbers, perhaps around $1 million.
Yeah, it'll probably be less, but it could be as much as $1 million. And again, the commercial sector will pay about 10%, a little less, and the residential pay about 90 or a little more, because that's the ratio. Town meeting has no role in that split between residential and commercial, nor do you. That doesn't mean you can't have an opinion and tell the selectmen. But town meeting very much has the key role in passing the home rule petition or not. And if they pass it, it would go on to the legislature and the governor. Objective of activating it next July 1st. So that catches you up on everything but sort of financial override budget things.
Just for a second, so in terms of in the packet, some of that information is on, oh, it's not there. Okay, so it's in his
own piece. No, I didn't bother putting tax classification stuff in here.
So
yeah, it's in the selectmen's
hand. The selectmen's packet, if you guys got a copy of it, it looks like this on the top. That actually has the tax classification information. And we will need to formally review and vote on that for the September town meeting.
Not clear.
I thought it has to be approved by town meeting.
Town meeting does, but FinCom, I don't know that you have a role in the home rule petition.
It involves money.
It doesn't. It involves reshifting revenue. It's not spending any money.
Mm-hmm.
It's not even raising any different amount of money. So.
But we could choose.
I think we may.
I don't know. As individuals, you always can. But as FinCom, I'm not sure.
When we chose to.
Well, you can try. you will run into resistance at town meeting if you vote on something that someone in town meeting doesn't think is appropriate. Some don't think it's appropriate to have the town meeting, just so you know.
Yeah, and some people are concerned that if we don't take a vote on things, that's we don't have that option to not take a vote or to abstain.
Right. But you know, there are some. The narrowest view you can take of FinCom is your advisory only when money is being spent by town meeting that evening. That's the narrowest view. The widest view is something to do with some financial issue that could impact the town. It's a little harder to argue that rearranging tax policy really affects the town unless you think it's going to impact the amount of people who move in or move out, I guess, and it would affect property values. So, you know, do what you want.
Yeah, I think the fact fact that town meeting has to vote on it, and it will be impacting people's pocketbooks. My view is absolutely something we should weigh in on.
Do they not have to give a report at town meeting on their thoughts on it?
I hadn't planned on it.
Okay.
Doesn't mean they can't.
Yeah, I think that the expectation that we've built up to is that financial, period, is something that we should have an opinion about. Or at least some kind of a report, if not a vote. So that would be my view. I'm open to other opinions, but I think that probably makes sense.
No, to me, that's in line with where we've been so far. I mean, as long as that's not creating an issue or problem that we can't do, and we'll deal with that if it comes.
I think it's going to create an issue, just so you know. That's my opinion.
And do you think with selectmen or people on town meeting?
I think town meeting, possibly selectmen. Effectively, you are stomping on an elected board's toes in some ways, but I think you're also going outside the bounds of what my perception of what town meeting expects of you. I don't know. What do you think?
It's funny. You asked me where, depending on what table I'm sitting at. as a selectman, I probably would agree with Bob in that, you know, we're not raising any additional funds. You know, we're not spending any additional funds. I think it's something that really emanates with the selectmen. As a town meeting member, I was just the average town meeting member, this is a complicated issue, and I'd want to, you know, more information is always better than less information.
That's
right.
What
so
I think
yeah.
the average
yeah.
town meeting
yeah.
member would say, what? Finance isn't?
You know, and
yeah.
that's
yeah.
right.
Now, whether or not the FinCom had been privy to the information that we were as a selectman, you weren't, just, you know, it was
yeah.
this, we wrestled with this for months. So how much more you could add,
mm-hmm.
other than maybe what you saw at the couple people were at the meeting or read in the briefing, I'm not sure. But, you know, as somebody who, you know, reads lots of memos all day about what we should be making decisions, more information is always better than less. But I agree with Bob that I think there will be some people that will take offense to the fact that you're weighing in.
With the override vote and everything, that doesn't sort of work its way into the senior credit as well.
you started that one.
Yeah.
But no, from the finance committee standpoint, where, you know, we are going to say something about the override, right? And
that
the fact
would,
that
yeah,
we're
that
giving an override and we're splitting. Yeah, and the fact that we're making people pay more of the override depending upon whether they're seniors or not. To me, it seems as though it's a factor.
What if we had, you know, we typically read our fairly generic introduction to, and we voted 500, right? And we kept it extremely short, but to the point of, hey, we looked at this a lot less than the Board of Selectmen did, but a lot more than you as the greater group were able to, you know, and whether we say it's a vote, but we give some, right, you share some information, again, to the point of more information is better than others. Acknowledge the fact that, yes, we have played a much smaller, I don't want to say played a role.
Yeah.
We were privy to a portion of this information. We took it very seriously. We looked at it. Here are our thoughts. Let's move on.
Is it kind of like the split tax rate where it's a board selection type of call sort of thing? Is that why?
Yeah, I would say
and
so.
It's the exception
it
of how the taxes are allocated is usually
right.
a board of selectmen.
Except this one takes a
right.
town meeting
yeah.
vote.
Right.
So
right. It's not approved.
To
that
Bill
Brown,
by the way, has jumped in his car a few minutes ago.
He's
come on down.
Bill. Yeah,
but
I know. All I'm pointing out is that there will be some people who object to this.
The next meeting because a lot of people
yeah.
been
yeah, yeah, no, yeah, no way we can review it here, and it's not, the warrant's not closed anyway.
You want to go back to Sharon?
Yeah. So let's make sure we have that on our agenda for the next meeting. Okay, Sharon, thank you for chasing. So let's look at policy establishment capital improvement advisory subcommittee on the finance committee.
I think the 5% here is on page 2 of the loan policy. From this way down, it's the middle column.
Yes,
and
it's
current
to 5. It should not be able to fall below 3.
Oh,
yeah. Oh, so there is a range.
Oh, this is the one that
this
is the
yes.
current.
You don't think so?
No.
Because the current has a date on it. Well, let's see.
This must have been when Bob
Alash
was on
the
FinCom.
This is the old one, 9 of 95.
This one was last updated on 2001 when I was looking at the
Yeah, there's one online.
Okay, I'll
FinCom.
I was looking in your shared folder.
Oh, good grief.
F197 is like 38 million.
Flashback.
It's only triple.
Current double A bond rating.
Oh.
Well, that's good to see the history anyhow, 3 and 5.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Two.
And by the way, you went below a lot, below 3.
Yeah.
I'm missing out.
You did, the town did go below 3.
Oh, yeah. And down to like, I don't know, $300,000.
Wow.
Eric, you were asking a little bit about some other towns. Just I had pulled together just a little bit of information. So Winchester has a minimum target of 6, and they have a goal level of 10. Lexington has a goal level of 7. Stoneham has a goal level of 10. Dedham has a goal level between 5 and 10, but the minimum is 5. And I was not able to find North Reading, Wakefield, or Linfield. I took these, I found these online. I didn't make any phone calls.
So some have a goal and a minimum.
Right. So where are we in terms of having kind of the two numbers? Having a target and a minimum. So I've heard a little bit of both.
I think I was sort of convinced by sharing that having both numbers is probably a good idea.
Target and the minimum.
Target and the
minimum. That way.
Yeah.
That sort of that yellow and red area.
Yep.
When you say target and minimum, you mean for target.
Target 7.
The target is
the at least. Sorry. Target is at least 7%. Okay.
And
the minimum
really
is 5.
If we go less than 5.
Okay.
It's interesting. So if you look at the page 3 on this, so you don't think that's it, Bob?
No, it's definitely not it.
It's written in an interesting way as though it's going to, if it's higher than 5, we'd start it down to 5. Yeah.
I do think
well,
that the wording matters.
A lot of, it was pretty skinny in those days, wasn't it?
Yeah.
Yeah,
there's
yeah,
also
so,
some.
But still,
I do think the wording matters when we're going to vote as to, you know, I think using target and minimum is a little
yep.
bit confusing. Is that right?
Yeah, it's all right. This is actually interesting. I haven't seen this one.
To see the old one?
Yeah.
Much longer document.
Yeah.
So this one just has the one number.
Yeah.
It's one
issue.
Yeah.
I bet you the other things like capital are on a different policy, right?
Yeah, say it's on me.
This one's kind of a joint.
So this is current.
Yes.
Which is minimum of 5. And so in essence what we'd be doing is adding, keeping that really just adding the target of 7.
Yeah.
Well, I
yeah.
think it depends on how it's worded. I think this the language in the draft that Sharon gave us is uses different language than target and minimum, such that you know the goal is at least 7, and then a balance of less than 5 is cause for concern. But you could read. You know, talking about at least 7 or equal to at least 7 suggests a, kind of like a target minimum, really.
Right, because I think the, I think our...
below 7, you'd be concerned.
No, but we're talking about at least 7. And that's, I mean, at least suggests a minimum, really.
Oh, I agree. I see
so,
what
you mean.
Yeah.
And that truly
oh,
is
I see what, you mean.
What we want
yeah.
the what we want the reserve to be is 7. We don't want to be somewhere and hope to strive for 7 in the future.
Mm-hmm.
So I do think the wording is important, right? I think
we are
replacing the 5 with 7. We can craft the words, but our intent, right, is to increase our reserve policy from 5 to 7.
But then do we want to add next sentence here is, further, FinCom recognizes circumstances which may occur which would require FinCom to raise or lower the minimum from time to time. Are we defining that there is a time where it could go down to five? And if it,
I think it depends on facts and circumstances at the time. You don't want to put it in the policy.
And that would argue just for staying with one number.
Yeah, right. I mean, if we need to, we can reduce it at the, but it's facts and circumstances.
It can go down as low as it needs to go.
Yeah, I mean, it's a reserve, so it's there for something.
So the reality is that if it went below seven, we would come back and we would, first of all, we'd say, what's going on? And second of all, we may have to come back and say, well, circumstances require that we change our guideline.
Yeah.
Or we live with currently being under our guideline.
Right.
Making changes to get back.
Right. And depending on how and why we got to below is going to change the time frame and the path towards getting back up to it.
Yeah, because changing it, lowering it would suggest we're comfortable or at least acknowledging that we're going to be lower for a while.
Yeah.
So are we thinking then to keep this language but change five to seven?
Yeah, I think so.
Would we want to ever add on the additional line that town considers a balance of less than 5% to be cost concerned for that same line and add it to the final top paragraph?
You could add it to the end of that last sentence in the first paragraph, comma, although. Yeah, I wouldn't overthink this.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. So let's wordsmith it. So if we change the five to a seven,
mm-hmm.
and then we add a sentence at the very back of the first paragraph, so below this minimum from time to time, period, then the next sentence would be the Finance Committee considers
a balance of less than 5%.
Do you want to use cause for concern, or do we want to say something along the lines of we'll be looked at, you know, like we'll be analyzed to figure out type deal, like say, hey, it hit five, like I hate the concern, I don't know why, I don't know why it bothers me, I don't even have it.
I agree. I can't figure out the scenario why it bothers me yet, but
I wouldn't write a, you know. Yeah, my
if I was by myself here, I wouldn't write those words. I
agree.
I can't put my finger on
like something. It's basically, we want it to trigger an event, right? Meaning further analysis or
considers a balance.
Or would essentially would less than seven cause us to, you know, take a look at what we're doing?
I think it's a given that we would.
So then we would.
But I like that under five, we're really not going there.
We can say 5%
unless we have to.
Or come up with
other
words.
You can't
words.
Prevent it from happening.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Just because you have a policy,
mm-hmm.
if it happens, it happens.
Mm-hmm. Right.
And I think
we
wouldn't
knowingly
that
going
right,
to that.
It triggers discussions about what's happening.
Right.
Would be
that's
your
it.
Fault
it's
by
it. We get it.
Yeah, I've been growing free cash since I've
been here. An amount below 5% will.
Just remember it's not
mm-hmm.
For what?
Well, I think we're going to know why it got to 5%.
How about
based on the. The facts that are presented to us?
FinCom considers a balance of less than 5% to require a formal. That's making it clear that it's concerning to you.
Yeah. I like that.
Right.
Without saying concern.
Concern,
right.
Yeah.
And it doesn't
yeah.
require you to say, okay,
a
we're
formal
not
review
money.
By whom?
You just have to
look at it, understand
triggers,
it.
You know,
a response.
An evaluation.
Although it's not good to use FinCom in the same sentence twice, but by the committee.
FinCom considers a balance of, what do you have it,
less than
5%
percent to require a formal review by the committee.
Beautiful.
So moved.
And you got a couple sevens to change from five.
Yes.
seven, if those are the only ones.
I believe so.
You know, while you're at changing it, the MSBA has changed the way they do business, so this net available revenue thing is out of date.
Right.
You could just change it and say of revenue, skip not available and skip as defined below. It used to be that we borrowed and then MSBA would reimburse some of the debt service on a yearly basis. Now they don't do that. If they change it again, that's different. So you could just scratch net available in the first paragraph and scratch the second to last paragraph completely.
Do we, because it digs into, do we have a definition of reserves? Do we want to take this definition from the fund balance policy?
Oh.
So we're completely consistent.
Of what? The definition of what?
So we say here it's 7% is cash reserves. So what are cash reserves?
So, Bob, are you proposing then taking out the whole net available revenue paragraph? That
yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, it's not really meaningful.
Yeah.
So, some
cash reserves
here,
remains
sort of free cash.
Well, I guess you got to look at it with the GASB 54 policy that Sharon's gave.
Yep.
And,
I think we should just match them.
Oh. Yeah.
Consistent with the town's fund balance policy is the easiest way to say it.
I like that, so you're not changing it
to
place.
Okay.
Can you read that back, Mark?
Yep. So. Now I'm looking at the paragraph that starts cash reserves. I would now say cash reserves are defined to be consistent with the town's fund balance policies. And that's, and then I guess we need the next sentence. Other reserves such as real estate funds, committed stabilization overlay.
Yeah, those are okay. That's okay.
Okay, so let me take it from the top for a minute so we're on the same page. So Finance Committee, August 2016. Finance Committee FinCom of the Town of Reading hereby establishes and adopts a policy establishing a minimum target for cash reserves of 7% of revenue, period. Further, FinCom recognizes that circumstances may occur which would require the FinCom to raise or lower this minimum from time to time. The FinCom considers a balance of less than 5% to, hang on, I gotta read
require a formal
to require a formal review by the committee. The second paragraph stays as is. That third funds in excess section stays as is. Then we go to the cash reserves paragraph. Cash reserves are defined to be consistent with the town's fund balance policies, period. And then the sentence other reserves, such as sale of real estate, committed stabilization overlay, are excluded from the 7% minimum requirement, though these funds may be considered if circumstances require higher reserves.
My only hesitation, where am I seeing the word cash reserves in the fund balance policy? Because if I read that, I would go right to here and it's
in the very the second line, the very top, target for cash reserves. It should be capitalized so that we're consistent. So the second line, first sentence, the second line. Finance Committee establishes and adopts a policy establishing
the
fund
balance policy.
You're
saying on the
fund
balance policy,
right.
Actual
right.
Fund balance policy, we're just talking about cash reserves,
right.
If we're referencing
sure,
it from
free
point.
Cash. But
right. Yeah.
Yeah,
it should be the same.
Yes.
Close enough.
That is confusing. Yeah.
Well, I guess, yeah, maybe we should take the sort of
unassigned fund balance.
Or is it this certified free cash?
Right.
Is it the certified free cash
exactly.
On the second page? Do we have to change the name to match?
And this is also a draft, so.
Yeah, and it's not just certified free cash, though.
No, it's not. And general stabilization fund.
So why don't we just go to these words here?
If you look at the third to last paragraph, this goal of the town to achieve, that's cash reserves.
Certified.
It doesn't say that.
Yeah, certified free cash plus general stabilization funds, right?
Yeah.
Is what it is. Alright, so let's figure.
So we'll use the same words.
Yeah, but let's figure out where. So instead of having the words cash reserves in our policy, should we just go to certified free cash plus general stabilization funds?
No, I don't think so.
No?
I think you should have a cash reserves policy, because that's what people have. You could just say cash reserves are defined to be certified free cash plus general stabilization funds as defined in the town fund.
Yes.
Don't worry, Caitlin, I'll do all this.
Okay.
She had her first breath in like 3 minutes. Certified free cash plus general stabilization. Consistent with, right?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Not general, but uncommitted, right? Stabilization.
That's where the general stabilization fund is. It doesn't have any restrictions other than 2/3 vote. Actually, now it's half.
Well, but are they actually defined in the fund balance policy? As defined.
That's the fund
in
balance policy's problem.
Certified free cash.
I think those aren't those generally accepted financial terms.
What's
general
that?
Stabilization fund and certified free cash.
Mm-hmm.
Everybody
that's the
knows
terms
what they
that
are.
DOR uses.
Yeah. Those are okay.
So then, do we even want to say are? Then do we even want to say are defined to create some kind of explanation of what cash reserves are?
I think it's helpful because stabilization funds. I mean, the average person is not going to have a.
The average person reading your policy.
I don't think we should refer back to the fund balance policy then, because it doesn't actually.
Mm.
We shouldn't say as defined in, which doesn't actually define them.
So what if we just stopped it as defined as certified free cash plus general stabilization funds? Period.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. No further reference to anything.
Yeah.
Good. My suggestion is that we create a clean version of this and vote on it at our next meeting.
Done.
How about
because I want to read
going
it.
Back
it's
to the way it was?
Yeah.
No, really. Read what's what it says.
Cash reserves defines the sum total of free cash, uncommitted stabilization funds.
I mean, just take out the net available revenue thing.
Yeah, I mean, cash reserves as defined in your policy are okay. Part of the
yeah,
policy.
I agree. So it's basically the same.
You know, uncommitted is not necessary. You could say general stabilization fund, whatever. Uncommitted is fine. There might be another one.
And
created. Our yeah, if you're going to, because, you know, is the FinCom reserve fund in your mind part of cash reserves? I'd say so.
Yes.
And
no,
in that
period,
does that five turn to a 7
grand,
also?
But it's available. Doesn't belong to us particularly.
Is that 5 turn to a 7 also in the sketch?
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
I'll bring this back to you at your next meeting. You can see what it looks like. Bold and cross out.
I think that's good.
Then you can decide.
And one suggestion, if you want to go to just free cash, maybe we should use the term certified free cash.
Yeah, I agree with that.
Just so there's no.
Anything that makes it sound not so free.
The fund formerly known as.
Let's come up with a symbol.
That's a good idea.
Okay, I think we should put that to bed for now.
That's good.
Okay, thank you. So let's come back to just to close off on the topic of the senior relief activities. There will be language coming from the Board of Selectmen meeting next week, I think.
Next week they'll close a warrant, so there has to be language from the petition. Ray is doing it today. Yeah, he and Victor and I chatted during the day.
Is it going to be short?
Ray is not paid by the word. He loves short. Yeah.
Okay, so if you could share that with us once the warrant closes, then we can all let's all take a look at it and read through and see what we've got. Okay, let's shift gears to the memo that's in tonight's packet on page 3.
For you folks.
folks, I'll go through this fairly quickly because it's all gonna be very familiar to you. I guess I will hit some of it that you wouldn't have necessarily heard about. The two chairs of the Selectmen School Committee and the superintendent and I sat down a couple times and had discussions about the budget model, and the schools were very satisfied with it. We had informally talked for years of whether we have just abandoned it or not, and I always left that up to the schools to have an opinion. And it's market timing. You know, if you jump out of the model and all of a sudden they're out of district special ed went up that year, they would have a hard time balancing their budget. If it went down, they would have extra. So, you know, after some discussion, they realized the model's worked well. It does have flexibility. If there's a year in which there's some cost that's new or different, there's a mechanism to deal with that. So they're fine with that. The current ratio is closer to 64-36 because facilities changed, just to put that out there. And then the next discussion that especially John and I had, and Sharon and I to a little bit of a lesser degree, is for purposes of deciding on what an override amount needs to be, what's the run rate of an operating budget? What should it be? I showed you a while ago that since the last override, it was closer to 3.2%, and that's an operating budget number again. That doesn't include accommodated costs. But in the last few years, it's been 3.6, 3.5, and then 1 year it was in the low threes, and that was a hardship. There were layoffs both for schools and town. So John and I thought, if we're asking for an override, we may as well use 3.5, not 3.25. It doesn't seem like a lot of money, but it actually matters in your assumptions. And that by having a target of 3.5 every year, hopefully with good financial management, that would allow us to add things during the period and not only hope for it once every 8 or 10 years in an override, so that you could actually from time to time do other things. So 3.5, we agreed, was a better assumption.
And then you look at accommodated costs separately.
Separately, yeah. So I have a spreadsheet that goes out to, well, I'll get to that. Well, I may as well describe the spreadsheet. On the revenue side, I started, Sharon looked at it, and we did it line by line, but then I described things here kind of in a summary level. The first assumption that was made was new growth. Recent new growth has been closer to 800,000 to 900,000. There it is, 830,000 over 3 years. That's been identified projects that are winding down that we knew about. Maybe there's another one around the corner. I mean, we know there is. There's some 40Bs, but you know, who knows when. It seemed like a good assumption was 500,000, which is the assumption we've been using for several years. It actually used to be 250,000 assumption 10 years ago. So 500 for a few years, and then boosting up to 1,000,000 by the end of FY24, because the selectmen and staff were engaged in some economic development activity, seemed like a reasonable assumption that wasn't too crazy. Local revenues, 2.5%. Again, not by design, just after the fact of looking at it all. The first controversial thing I would say, and I cite it right here, is state aid. The impact of what you assume state aid to be is huge, because it's such a big number and it can be so volatile. FinCom has had a recent policy that 2.5% is a reasonable assumption and any shortfall can be supplemented with free cash. If I use 2.5% in this model, the override grew by more than I think it should.
Really?
Yeah. It really, over a period of time, 0.5% makes a big difference, believe it or not.
I'm sure I'm jumping ahead, but then what's the assumption you made for
free cash use?
Or help.
8. Throughout. Those are the two big ones. So
yeah.
I decided to be less conservative, if you will, in state aid by assuming 3 and then saying, maybe FinCom will step in if it's below 3 with cash reserves. Because again, this model is now removing a lot of reliance on cash reserves. I won't say to 0, that's a future discussion. So that's, and let's not spend a lot of time on it because we can come back to it. But 3% is a state aid assumption that's important for you to know. And then local, the other category is very low because the RMLT dividend is the big driver, and that's a COLA based. Rather a CPI-based number.
CPI is like 0.
Close, yeah, it's 0 to 1.
No, we haven't had
not in state aid, not for a few years.
Yeah.
It's been
less than 2.5, right?
Oh yeah.
Yeah.
It's been
right.
It's
right.
been in the ones and slightly below one
mm-hmm.
for like said let's
mm-hmm.
say the last 3 or 4 years.
Just for round numbers, if we were to look at let's say what's 1% difference in state aid, what would that represent in dollars?
Right? Another $500,000 of an override.
$500,000 override, but if it was free cash being used to supplement it.
Let's get back to that then, okay?
Okay.
So using this, revenues are 3.2 in the early years, 3.5 in the later years, just to give you a color. Accommodated costs, again, the most important one's health insurance. There is no actuarial study I have seen that uses 8% forever. It's always 8% scaling down because otherwise we'll all go nuts. You know, and that's always a nice assumption that people make, but it's maybe not realistic.
Well, then what happened like in Orange County and those places where they just went bankrupt?
Well, they just used derivatives.
Oh,
they just
yeah. It had nothing to do with their assumptions.
Well,
I guess their assumption was trees grow to the sky and never stop.
Right, because the other tweaking we can do is lower the revenue, but then also lower the accommodated costs.
You could. And I decided it doesn't really matter. You're right, you could. But 8% is an acknowledged national health insurance number now. For how long? Your guess is as good as mine.
Right.
So
what
I used it forever.
What have our actuals been?
5.5, 6. At a time when the run rate in the national level has been higher than 8. But we've run out of tricks in that, just like we are in everything else. And
so
then,
you kept 8 on
that. Yeah. And then a really important assumption was a discussion Sharon and I had, which you may or not, may not agree with, which is to shorten the pension schedule and contribute more.
Hmm.
If we're going to go to all the trouble having an override, we thought this is an opportunity to shorten pension funding because we've got to get to OPEB, and that's the only way it's going to happen. You could make the argument that part of an override could be for OPEB. I don't think anyone would really support that, but the finance team would. It's a good financially, you know, practical policy. And some communities have, well, some communities actually have done that. They've had overrides to fund OPEB, period. Not many, but there's a couple.
Yes.
Yeah,
those are the ones that have, that they're teaching honors physics.
Yes, in many languages. Yeah, that's true.
In Monday's paper, there was an article about pension returns, and it was below that,
yeah, that
extends
the headline.
Yeah, appropriate, right on the front page. Did that change our funding? Because I think it said 2029.
Well, that gets into the area. This is like, you know, actuarial science. Again, the actuaries make assumptions because it's convenient, and to do otherwise would be a disaster. So when I used to manage money, oh, it's the time. When I used to manage money for pension funds, they always had an assumed rate of return they had to meet to hit their match their liabilities. One side of the company wanted it high, one side wanted it low. So it had nothing to do with math. It was all politics. With our pension fund, it's the same thing. What is it, 7.5 now, I'm going to guess? Assumed rate of return.
Yeah, I think that's what the
seven and
said.
Okay,
yeah.
That's typical. That's
it
too high.
It was 7.75 when we went down on the assumption for
yeah.
7.5 for the rate.
Any reasonable financial markets person would tell you, in reality, 7.5 is too high. But if you change it from 7.5 to 7.25, it's an unmitigated disaster for every pension fund in the country, so no one does it. So given all that, I think we need to be a lot more prudent with our pension fund, because what we don't want is the state to suddenly go, look, cut it out, you guys all got to kick in another $1 million a year, because we told you 2029 was the hard deadline and none of you are getting there. You just don't know. So that's something that I think we have more control. OPEB does,
yeah.
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 And again, the real advantage in funding pensions faster, as fast as we really can afford to, is you get to OPEB, and I'll guarantee you there's going to be a FinCom in 10 or 15 years from now that's going to hate you if you don't hurry up and get to OPEB. Because it's going to
yeah.
be the next disaster. And we don't have, you know, $500,000 is not bad. It's better than zero to go to OPEB. And it's a nice cushion if health insurance is above that 8%. But it's not the $2 million that you need, or $1.75 million, whatever it is.
Only feedback on that, the the auditor didn't really lash us about
no.
where we are.
No, I'm sure. No, because we're not worse than
we're
most
doing better
people.
Than most.
Yeah. Right.
That doesn't
right.
Mean
doesn't mean it's
great,
good.
Right.
But
it's
just,
still better than most.
Yeah. And they weren't kind of beating the drum.
So,
because so many are just pushing it to the side,
yeah.
saying I'm going to be aggressive about funding
yeah.
pension and I'll worry about the OPEB later. We are still doing something to OPEB, be it kind of small, but still something. And then the enterprise funds are fully funding, so that always looks good, but there's a much smaller piece of the pie.
Yeah.
So.
You know, it's also what Reading approaches almost everything as. We take our infrastructure much more seriously than most communities. We actually fix it till it, you know, we don't wait till it breaks. Other communities wait till it breaks and then get extra money from the state or the feds. There's no real right or wrong answer there. But Reading is typically more proactive in most things, so I think that's consistent. I mentioned in here your policy about capital and debt, and I'm going to come back to that. I have a meeting with Joe Huggins tomorrow on facilities capital. I don't think, absent a couple big projects, I don't think that 5% is necessary in the long run for capital anymore because we're so caught up. I'm sure that will change, but just to throw that out there. So
right, each of these percentage points ends up having a significant impact.
Yeah, so when you bake all this together, what you come up with, which you all know is a funding gap. So there's a run rate of revenues, there's a run rate of the operating budget is 3.5, and I said revenues are 3.2 to 3.5. So there's a little bit of a gap there, and especially in the early years. And then accommodated costs are 5.5, which is a bigger gap with 3.5% revenues. So the first table is your accommodated cost gap, and it's about 660 grand a year. It's a real simple way to look at it. You guys all know this because you've lived it through budgets, but I've never actually put it in simple terms like this. And the $660,000, you know, near-term gap, we always find a way to lower it. Not always to zero, but if you remember, it wasn't many years ago, only two, I think, that $1 million balanced the budget. Now it's two. Well, this is why. It's because there's a gap. Every so often, the gap hurts you. You look out to FY25.
Sorry, can we just back up on one?
Mm-hmm.
And the energy costs were forecasted 5.
Right.
Okay.
A little high or low?
I thought that's a little high.
I thought it was low. Who knows?
Mm-hmm.
Same thing with, I think, out of district special ed is 5. It's pretty rare that it's much lower than 5, but it hasn't been higher than 5 by much in the last few years. It used to always be double digits.
Exactly.
Yeah.
You know, that's probably the biggest
swimmer.
Used to be health insurance and energy.
Yeah.
And you know, maybe special ed came in the conversation. Now energy costs have stabilized, we've done really good on health. It's the special ed thing that just is really volatile.
Mm-hmm. Although I think special ed was a bigger issue.
It was a much bigger issue 10 years ago for a couple reasons. John has done a really nice job bringing more special ed services in district.
Mm-hmm.
Aside from, you know, that being obviously better for kids, it's financially more predictable. When you're, you know, reliant on outside vendors or services, you just, what can you do? You just have to pay them.
And arguably much more cost effective
yeah.
per pupil basis.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
So 660,000 a year for year two is not so bad, but look how fast that grows. So you got a $5 million annual gap in 8 years. That's not cumulative, that's annual. By contrast, you can see the operating budget funding gap is much smaller. You know, as I said, it's almost in line with the revenue estimate. So that all leads you into the next page, which is the math, which is right now it's a true statement to say there's a $3 million structural deficit, approximately $2 million and $1
million. And how do you get the $3 million? Do you add?
I actually ran real numbers, and that's what it is. But the explanation for it is $2 million you used last year, $350 more for pensions, and this annual gap of $660. So that's about $3 million. That's a reasonably good.
Oh.
Yeah.
Can
you say that one more time? Sorry, that bridge is.
$2 million of free cash,
yes.
$660 of annual gap, $2.66 million, more pension funding, $3 million.
Yeah. So how have we been covering the $660
by going like crazy trying to cut our accommodated costs.
So, right, so we've been having lower assumptions on our accommodated costs.
Well, we've had lower actual results.
Right, but it's not just actuals, we're balancing a budget based on assumptions.
No,
right?
We're balancing budget on actuals. I mean, well, we've had to lower accommodated costs through planned activities as best we can. It's harder to do that more than a year at a time. It's harder to say, well, in the fifth year, we'll do this to health insurance.
Mm-hmm.
It's easier to do it right now.
Right.
But we've actually hammered away at them as best we can. There has been several years in the last 10, there's been several years where our operating budget grew faster than accommodated costs. So the years where there was 3.6 and 3.8% is because our accommodated costs were close to zero, because revenues didn't go much above 3.
That's right.
Anytime you look out in the future, though, your accommodated costs are going to seem bigger. There's no way to avoid that as long as health insurance is 8. It's as simple as that, unless you change your capital policy. So, you know, this is part of the assumption that is, I guess I'll say, conservative. But just because we've always figured out a way to have accommodated costs not be 5.5 doesn't mean we always can. I shouldn't say we always have, because we haven't always. There's been years it's been 6 and 7.
I'm just concerned this multiplier, because I know this is just going to be really big.
And there it is in the middle of page 5, the $3 million structural deficit to FY25 means a $6 million override, and to last to FY30 is a $13 million override.
So how does it get from 3 to 6 in 8 years?
If you go back to that other page,
mm-hmm.
you'll
that
see that the annual gap's gapped out to 5 million. So you got to add up all those numbers in that table and somehow pay all those annual gaps.
Mm-hmm. It's compounding of the deficit.
Right, that adds up to more than 6. If you add up all these columns, it adds up to more than 6.
And then divide by 8 years.
Oh, okay. By your
average. So that's about it. It works out pretty close.
So you don't compound the gap.
Well, yeah. So you guys will understand philosophically that there's a deficit now, and you know, under Prop 2.5, there will always be the appearance of a deficit getting worse, always. Whether it really happens or not depends on how clever you are and
right.
some of the things you can do. You know, on the revenue side, unfortunately, our options are pretty limited. The new growth we're working on, if everything worked out tremendously, might add $2 million a year. That's the best case. That's a lot of money, but it's not going to solve what you see here. And that's, you know, 5 years down the road anyhow.
And
so,
when you say $6 million override, based on how you went through that, you can structure it in such a way that it's not 6 the first year, right?
This assumes it's 6 right away.
That does confuse me.
You only need 3 in the first year, and you
right.
need to put 3 in the bank for the future. That's what it really boils down to.
Okay.
It's operating, you're still
raising your
spend 3.5%
right.
yeah.
You can't actually do that.
Right,
that's
so I get that you need it, but I thought you'd structure it in such a way. But you're saying
later.
It's assuming
you know,
put it in the bank. And
see, unfortunately, an override has to be structured with a finite dollar amount.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
If you could say, let's raise property taxes by 3 or 3.5% a year instead of 2.5, we'd be all set. It would be the same money for a period, but that's not how you're allowed to do it.
I thought at one point you spoke about setting a number, but you don't go to that number until year 3 or something.
We had talked about whether we have a phased override.
Yeah.
I don't think you can do
you know, you can. The state was definitely frowning on it.
Okay.
DOR probably.
Yeah, DOR definitely frowned on it. But you could effectively go out to the community and say, we're going to assess a $10 million override. But we're not going to actually impose the first $5 million on you for 5 years.
So it could kind
so,
of be phased
exactly.
in with the library.
But it would be a $10 million override in the DOR's mind,
right.
but you just don't fully tax property.
Mm-hmm.
And the selectmen decided, you know, that's such a huge moral
trust.
Obligation leap.
Yes, it is.
No. You know, that's crazy. But yeah, mathematically you could do that. But you're also then asking for a bigger number than you need right away. That's the number you're going to need someday.
So, and I apologize for jumping. These are the questions I would have asked last night had we had a shorter, you know, shorter meeting.
Or
right,
gone till 1 a.m.
Or 1 a.m.
Right.
So, obviously, to get to the 6 million, it's based on assumptions that you're making sort of 8-year assumptions. Normally when we do a budget, we're doing a year, and maybe if we're really smart, we try to do 2-year budget. Now we're trying to do 8-year budget. That's like trying to hit, like, you know, hit a baseball, you know, into like a little hole from 100 yards. So, you know, your assumptions, you're not really gonna know about your assumptions until you're 8 years out.
Right.
So let's just say, for example, we get really lucky or good on health insurance. Energy, you know, oil goes, you know, $20 a barrel. You know, our economic development plan is a home run before we even, you know, a lot sort of, and, you know, so all of our assumptions are on the positive side. You know,
mm-hmm.
if we were too conservative. But yet we've asked for all this other money. It's not inconceivable that, you know, let's say 6 years from now, we don't spend the left to the left, right?
That's a possibility, but the other way to look at it, which the town would have done in the past, had it really thought about it in these terms, is the override lasts longer than you planned.
Mm-hmm.
So it's only designed to last to 25, but if all those things happen, it's going to last to 30.
Right. But I think the way to try to explain it is that, you know, think about, you know, trying to create your own home budget for for the next 8 years. Well, you don't really know
right.
what to plug in. But, you know, if your estimates were wrong, and you know, to your benefit, right, you don't have to spend all the money that you got. I don't think that's ever been an option with us before.
Wakefield does that occasionally.
North Reading did it last year.
Did they?
Wow. And I sat in their meeting when they did it.
Spend to their levy?
Yeah.
No, and it was like, of course we're not spending to our levy. I think they do that all. It's like, and that's the first time I even thought that was possible.
Yeah. Yeah,
so,
you're right. It's the selectman's call again to do that.
So
no
I think it's appropriate to say, let's budget conservatively, so therefore the number we're asking for is higher, right? Because we want it to cover that period of time. But we can also say to people that, you know, if we were wrong in a positive way, you know, we don't necessarily have to spend it.
But don't you have to, in that case, take your level higher, because you're not banking any cash in that scenario?
Well, let me go on, because I don't think saying to the community, we need $3 million, so if we're asking for six, does anything. That's just like,
right.
okay, ask for three or come back tomorrow. Let's talk a little about a way to spend the six right away, but not recklessly. If you picture costs going up in the future and you picture upward sloping lines, there's a gap that's widening between revenues and costs that looks like a cone. It gets worse and worse as you get further out. It goes from 660 a year to 5 million in year 8. What you need is a set of costs that behave the opposite way, that go down every year. That would help offset that cone. It won't fix it, because there's no
cool.
such cost.
Where do we find those?
Capital. You start by spending more capital, cone it the other way to spend less. So if on average 5% is $3 million a year, maybe you spend $4 or $5 million in the first year and you scale it down to not something unreasonable, probably small, but that's a mathematical way to do it. Whether it's good or not, it's just the only way, it's the only cost we have any control
another
over where you could do that.
Cost you could do that on is pension and OPEB.
Pension, you're not allowed.
You're not allowed to do at least what you could fund it for the project.
Yeah, there's a minimum.
There's a minimum.
You can never go down.
Yeah.
Same with snow and ice.
Oh, so you can never
right.
put extra in. And,
OPEB isn't mandated.
OPEB,
so
you can do anything you want.
We are at
yeah.
base. We're like at 500,000.
So you're saying that at some point, go to 4% on the capital?
Well, what I'm suggesting is, as a thought process, spend more capital in the first year and less each year to year 8,
mm-hmm.
consciously. The other thing is, this is what it looks like today. To your point, every year you're going to adjust all your assumptions. You just got to start with this model and adjust it every year, and just track it. I don't know if you go back far enough to the Federal Reserve policy where they had M1 and cones. Every year they'd adjust. Well, this is what we thought, but this is where it is. You do the same thing here. This is what we thought, but this is where we really are. Now these are the adjustments we, you know, should or shouldn't make.
And again, these are just the deficits. This is nothing additional.
Right. Yeah, we're still only on the deficit. So by, I won't say good fortune, but by coincidence, we do have some unknown amount of high school litigation. If we could guess a number, and it's more than we can afford with free cash, how do you pay for it? You have to borrow. There's no other choice. So, you know, one way is you borrow for 10 years and you pay whatever it is a year. And, you know, if you do that, you're incurring a significant amount of interest costs on the debt. It'd be awfully nice to structure that, if we knew it and if we had it timely, to fit into this, let's spend more capital up front and always start defeasing that liability in big bite-sized pieces. And maybe only have 2 or 3 years of debt instead of 10. So that's one way to do this. I don't know that the timing will work out. I have no idea when we're going to know what this is. But that's one way to approach it, and that's...
You look for opportunities at the one-time cost.
Yeah.
Beginning the model.
Because if you do that way, you know, a capital plan has a certain amount of flexibility, but it's not really meant to be messed with the way I suggest it mathematically.
Right.
Let's buy all the fire trucks this year, and then... I guess
pray nothing breaks.
And 10 years from now, we're going to have to buy them all again because they're all going to wear down at the same time. You're supposed to stagger your capital, most of it, or a lot of it. But this litigation is completely flexible. You know, you want to pay it as fast as you can. So that just gives you another thing to think about in terms of how do you explain to the public why you need $6 million. Well, we need $3 million in operating structural deficit. We need $2 million on additional capital. We want to put $500,000 more to pensions and $500,000 in the bank. I'm not sure the bank part is technically legal, but there's a way you can do that.
But I think that's the appropriate word.
Right.
Keep it simple.
Right. Because I think $3 million and then $3 million in the bank doesn't work for me as a voter.
Mm-hmm.
I can tell you that.
But I would think that for the same reason why you would, when you had the free cash discussion, you know, having money in the bank is a good thing to hedge against future costs so that we don't have to come asking for here.
But do you want to pay those taxes now? And
yeah,
are you going to be living here in 5 or 10 years?
Right.
Not everybody can see that far.
Right.
So why do you want to bank? It's like condo reserve funds. Do you want to pay extra in your condo reserve fund to fix a roof 20 years down the road? You might be selling a condo in 10 years.
Mm.
Is there an option to pay down some debt? Early?
Not any existing debt. We've done all that. It's
even the most
callable.
Recent?
It's not callable. No. Any future debt we can mess with, and
yeah.
Instead of borrowing this many years, do shorter or whatever. But that just, you know, by the math, that fits in, that probable liability fits in nicely into this framework. And it's really important to keep in mind, you know, I ran some numbers. It's not hard to save $500,000 to $1 million of interest on this by cutting it to 2 years from then. I mean, interest is a killer on debt, even at low interest rates.
But if you don't get the override, you can't commit to paying it off in 2 years.
No, absolutely not.
Okay.
Right. Yeah, absolutely not.
Refinance it with no debt.
Bob, do you, this would mean having to go through the archives from 13 years ago. Do you know the analysis that went into the dollar amount that was chosen for? If I remember correctly, and I've got terrible memory.
Schools need this. Town needs this. Here's a couple extra things total.
I think it was on
exactly.
A bar now.
It was. I read all the minutes, and I was there for some of them as a FinCom member.
Oh, good. Let's throw it.
No thought to the future at all. And you know what? It's worked out for a long time.
That's my
but opinion. Not because of anything they did then.
Right. My only concern is we plan so much for the future that we...
Yeah.
Because I don't think any future planning was done with that.
No, not at all. I looked.
Yeah. I remember being that and going, oh yeah, another 200 for highways. It was literally...
Right, exactly. Yeah, it was. No, you're absolutely right. The discussion started in late January and there was an override in April. It did not even start until late January. Actually, it was February when Richard Foley noticed all these budget requests you guys are giving me can't possibly balance.
Although,
because he was the town accountant and school business
person. The
previous
years we had already requested.
Oh, there'd been problems, but no one knew the magnitude of the problem until he started aggregating all the budgets for FinCom. Said, woo.
What was the amount?
$4.5 million.
On a budget that was probably...
It would translate to an $8.5 million override today as a percent.
And there was no thought given to an endpoint.
The only thought that I saw was there was a contribution to the general stabilization fund in that first year. That's why it's there. like 700 grand or something like that.
But I mean, in terms of like,
no,
picking this number because we expect it to last.
Well, there was a discussion that we should do an override every 10 years.
Yeah.
And I think there was a discussion that this one really ought to last 8, but I didn't see any
math. But that wasn't in the numbers.
No. No, and this doesn't help the average person. This is just for you guys to understand the thought process. But it is difficult. If you did a $4.5 million before and you showed 3.8 million of expenses right away, and then 700 in the bank, but we're gonna spend it the second or third year, that's a lot different than, we need 3, so give us 6.
And again, assuming you start with the 3 versus, oh, two else and need another.
Yeah, and that's the next section is on page 6. Because I feel very comfortable that our assumptions are conservative and that I hope Barry's right that things will be better. Anything you add to this override can just go dollar for dollar as far as I'm concerned. So if you do the math at 3.5%, a dollar spent in addition in the first year should cost you $1.30 over the period. You should be asking for $1.3 million for $1 million override, just like we asked for 6 to pay for 3. Forget that. Just go 1 for 1. It's close enough. You know, so that's gonna eat into the good things you do, but I think we're fine with that. So the schools have asked for almost $2 million. So in the ratio, the towns put together a list of almost around $1 million, and that's on the next page. Selectmen haven't gone over this yet, and what's on this page is going to look different than what you're going to see tomorrow. The tax stuff you decided does not require as much assessing help as I would have put in there. So I've actually cut out some of that and just changed some numbers, but the basic story is the same.
And A through E only shows the town side?
Yes, the schools have a total. They don't have it prioritized in groups.
Okay.
They just have 1.925 million in no priority order. Just for the benefit of the selectmen after discussion with the department heads, I thought it was better for them to see what they would get for the different override points. And then it'll be up to the school committee next week as to whether or not they want to have that discussion in public, which my guess is no. They'll just want to arrive at it when they do. So that, again, the working assumption is $6 million to do the structural part for 8 years. And then I think a reasonable minimum additional is $1 million. I think anything smaller than that's silly to even think about.
And these are, I think this is, just for clarification, these are essentially examples that the select, you know, these wouldn't be binding appropriations.
Well, it's binding if we put it in the question, and I would urge them not to, and I don't think they will.
Yeah.
That's the only way, and then it would only be binding for the first year, although if you're going to hire someone, you're probably not going to fire them.
Mm-hmm.
But honestly, it's what we do is as long as the information we have doesn't significantly change when the real budgets are built. But same with the school committee. They have a list. They have $1.9 million. It's in their own minds. Somehow it's prioritized, but when they build the budget in the winter, they decide what really to do.
And did they break it down? I can't remember the school.
They have
brought it down.
They have
like
6 or 8
A, B, C, D, E,
and not that way. No.
Or like top
categories.
Middle.
They have it in unprioritized order, so it might be high to low in dollar costs. I don't even remember. And the one I do remember is it's the same as ours. Their first priority. Well, I shouldn't say that's the first thing they listed. Our top priority is employee retention and attraction. So they have some dollar figure on. I don't remember what it is. Out of their $1.9 million, there's a chunk of money for existing employees, teachers primarily.
Bob, I'm just missing how to read this. On A, you know, $1 million additional overhead.
Mm-hmm.
Is that just for the first, because then it keeps saying another 0.5?
A $7 million override at the top would, by formula, give the school $640,000 and the town $360,000.
Oh, $1 million total.
$1 million total.
Town. Okay, so I was wondering why, what?
So A is that the town's $360,000 share, and then each additional letter is additional $500,000 overrides. And again, the town really approached it differently than the schools. The schools went bottom up by need. They didn't care about this format, and they didn't know about it. And they spent a lot of time on the individual items. This is important, this is less important, here's the list. The selectmen were so busy doing other things on tax policy that they didn't have all summer, honestly, to sit down and argue about these priorities. These priorities are, you know, pretty much unanimous consent of department heads. And they've all been out in the public for the last 2 or 3 years in the budget documents. I don't think there's anything in here. With the possible exception of, yeah, it's not in this version, but Barry's going to see $20,000 for public safety overtime for joint training of police and fire. They did one exercise last spring and they really thought it was beneficial. So that has never appeared in a public request, but all this stuff has been out there.
It's interesting, firefighters over police officer.
Say again.
That the firefighter is shown as a higher priority over a police officer.
Where do you see that?
Well, just A, it's an A, and the other one's a C, right?
There's a school resource officer.
The school resource officer is a police officer, so they're all in pairs.
Oh, okay.
We should all in pairs.
I almost got in trouble with them.
I see, one of each.
So the school's had a...
Teach Craig not to come.
That's right.
School's had a $2 million structural.
You see that letter E? I think it was $1,925,000, so it's pretty close to what this would reflect, a $9 million overlook. They had a little less than, they had a $2 million structural,
right,
and an almost $2 million extra.
That's
cost.
Where I'm going. So
yep.
E gets them to the, gets their $2 million extra.
Yes.
Okay. Then we would have to do the $9 million to get the
yes.
schools all they're asking for.
Right. And it didn't, and one of the school committee members last night just thanked me for putting this out there. And since that's what they asked for, it seemed completely silly to discuss anything higher. I mean, I don't know what we'd spend it on. None of us discussed it. So it seems to me that a $6 to $9 million override is the framework. And at least from discussions I've been party to, a $6 million override with no additional stuff does not work. Has to be something new. That's the discussions
mm-hmm.
I've heard for months.
Mm-hmm.
So and that's what came out clearly at the listening session.
Yeah, I agree. So I think 7 to 9 is the range the selectmen look at next week. Talk to the trustees, talk to the school committee, and we'll see where it goes. And again, based on the prior override, $8.5 million would be the most, you know, look-alike. But let me just see if I put this stuff in here. If you go to the next page, page 9, I'll skip right over budget reductions. We don't need to talk about that. This is how it looks to the customers. So today, the average tax bill's, let's say, $7,250 for a $500,000 house. There's the pieces, the high school, the library, and the actual tax levy. Jump down to the next chart, and that's the 10-year projection of what your tax bill would look like if nothing else changed in an average house. It's going to go up 2.3% a year, not 2.5%, because the high school and library are declining. And then in FY25 and 26, first the high school, then the library are fully repaid, so they go away. So if nothing changes, the average single family house over the next 10 years pays 2% annually property tax bill. Less in years 25 and 26, but 2% compounded.
And then what happens in 27? Why that jump?
Then you go to Prop 2.5. There's no excluded debt, so from then on forever you'd go to 2.5%.
Right, 2.5.
Yeah. What's the override impact? There's different classes of property on the residential side, 500,000 being the median. The $6 million override, you know, costs the typical house $664 and so forth. A $9 million is just under $1,000 a year. You go to the next page on page 10. This is where you see the power of compounding. Over that 10-year period, a $6 million override changes the 2% to 2.9. If you were to ask a taxpayer, you know, are you willing to pay 2.9% a year for the next 10 years instead of, will you pay a $6 million override? I think you get a much more positive response. That's just what the numbers suggest. And then a $9 million override is 3.4% a year. So this drives at the problem, which is the structural problem, is the 2.5% a year is not enough, given current facts. But 3 or 3.5 would be plenty. It's funny how close those numbers sound,
yes,
but they just aren't.
Right, almost no concern wherever it is. It's really.
Well, it was when it was invented, and health insurance hardly changed, and was fully paid by the employer. So I think those are the takeaway points. I don't think the rest is really worth going over.
It's a good packet.
But you know, it's important that people see not too much data, and there's less. Now that the selectmen made a decision last night, there's definitely less. But they have to understand how it impacts them. And this shows what it costs, and now they have to understand, what do I get if I'm willing to pay these amounts? And if I'm not willing to pay, what do I lose?
So the debt coming off in 25 and 26 really pulls down. So you said it's 2.9 on a 6 million, but if that debt wasn't coming off, that 2.9 turns into a what? North of 3 million?
I'm not sure how to answer that. If there had been no such thing as the debt, is that what you're saying?
Well, because it comes off in 25
yep.
and 26, the increase there is less than 1. Right, which pulls down your.
I guess the way to look at it is, in the first scenario of no override, 2.5% a year under Prop 2.5 becomes 2 because of the excluded debt we have. So it's cut in half off on average.
Doesn't that add to it when you go to 2.5 plus you have the excluded?
Well, it's more money, but it's less of a growth because the debt doesn't go up 2.5% a year.
Yeah.
The debt actually, one of them's level and one of them declines.
So this is sort of like.
So your debt portion of your tax bill is going down every year,
right.
And then disappears.
Right.
And that's why your tax bill's going
right.
up.
The override lasted 2025 is a good time for.
Well, and that was the thinking behind the target is.
The excluded debt is going away,
yeah.
And they're going to see some relief on their tax bill, and if another override is needed, that would be.
Yeah.
Right.
And this assumes no new projects.
Correct. Well, it doesn't assume that, but it doesn't
no,
show
no
it.
Debt
excluded.
No excluded.
Yeah.
Right.
The two that are clearly
out there is Killam and a DPW garage.
Yep.
Cemetery garage may or may not be inside the levy. Your policy says no, but it's already in the capital plan, and that's for another discussion. Those are the only three projects, and I'll really say two, that John or I can think of today that are likely to be debt exclusions.
Okay.
And we would not want them part of the override. It doesn't make sense. They're one-time capital projects with a cost. You know, DPW we hope to link to economic development, may or may not work. Killam is just a cost. You pay it over however many years and you're done. You know, before you guys were on FinCom and I was, we did Barrows and Wood End inside the tax levy, and it was a huge mistake.
And Birch Meadow, right?
Repairs to it, yeah. But Wood End was built almost entirely inside the levy, and Barrows was renovated almost entirely inside the levy. There's very small amounts that got stuck onto the high school debt outside the levy. And that, first of all, that crowded out the rest of capital spending for a period of a few years. Got the reserves really low and hurt the operating budget. So, you know, money is money.
I thought there was an override for Barrows.
There was a tiny one. There was a tiny debt exclusion.
Maybe
that
additional.
It was like additional work at the end of the project
yeah,
or in the middle of the project
yeah,
or something.
Right.
Maybe $1 million total between the two schools. Maybe less, 700,000.
So I remember the first vote was to build a new school to repair Barrows, and I think they voted to repair Barrows and not build a new school.
Right, one worked, one didn't, I forget.
And then the next year there was another vote, and they both won, but I don't remember.
But no sidewalks.
Right.
The smallest one was this
right.
tiny
I remember
one.
That.
Right.
Right. Kids cricket.
People felt they had
to
vote no on something.
Right.
Right.
$500,000.
Which
yeah,
is probably
sidewalks.
Why, you know, getting to like sort of what all this looked like is a formal question. It's like, as one selectman, my view is to have one question, one number. You know,
for the general operation of the town and the schools
exactly.
and the library, period.
Because you don't want people to say, well, you know, I want to help the schools, but, you know, I got a ticket, so I'm going to screw the police department.
That's some crazy results.
Right. So it's either, you know, we're one town, one tax bill.
Sidewalks were $200,000, and we were asking
So, you know, to me, the linchpins of this that are hard to get over are the real cost of the structural deficit is not what it is today. That's a hard thing. And then the fact that you might mess around with capital to sort of, I'll say disguise, but really sort of take care of how that looks in a legitimate way. You know, we're working on capital plans right now. We're not going to bring any changes other than some that are required to September. November we will, but it's not a good idea to change your capital plan drastically all by itself. You don't want to, all of a sudden spend another million or 2 million bucks on equipment. Now, I'll give you another example. We have $500,000 for a dispatch center and 2 or 3 half-million-dollar turf fields. In theory, you could do those anytime, certainly the dispatch center. One turf field's new, so you could do that anytime. The others you kind of want to replace on some schedule. But once you get past just those 3 or 4 items, other than litigation, there's nothing that you would just say, oh yeah, we can do it now or we can do it in 5 years. What's the difference? It's like, no, the fire truck needs to be now within a year or two. The dump truck now within a year or two. Facilities repairs are similar generally. You know, roofs, maybe you can put a 3 or 4 year window over when you really need to do the roof, but you don't want to wait too long. So I'm not suggesting we drastically change your capital plan, your capital policy. But there's going to have to be some flexibility and creativity, I think, to make this work. And that was the hardest piece for me, was getting something that went the wrong direction on costs and having it be a legitimate thing. And I think it is. So that's what the selectmen will see next week, if they've seen it in writing but not in discussion. And that gives you a good overview, and the school committee has also seen it in writing.
Yeah.
So the joint meeting, next week is a joint meeting.
I don't know if the school committee or trustees will have a quorum. I haven't heard yet. There will definitely be some members from each there, though.
I'm sorry, which meeting?
So next week.
Next Tuesday.
Is the presentation of this to the selectmen, but they also need to close the warrant.
Right.
So this is kind of the deep dive that's...
So we already have a question on that too.
No, it would be ideal if you agreed on the form of a question generally, how many questions, and a number.
A dollar.
You have to have the language exact by September 12th.
So basically...
Sooner is better, clearly.
So, I mean, conceivably we can do it after the meeting on,
You meet next week, and then you meet September 1st. You guys meet August 31st.
Are we coming to the interview?
I don't know. I haven't really thought about that. That's a long way off.
Yeah, I know.
Beyond today.
Day by day.
I say to town council, we need that money. He goes, that's a long way off. I said, yeah, I couldn't agree more. But September 1st is a community financial forum in which all of us have to explain to the community what's going on. So ideally, I think... be really nice to have the exact language of a question then, so there's no wondering about it.
And I think you guys last night, didn't you say that you would put it together by the end of the month? That's what I thought.
That's the best effort.
Although if there's agreements,
you can do it right away. Yeah.
You can do it conceptually next Tuesday night, and then Ray can actually work on exact language. That's somewhat of a detail. If it's a real simple construct, then it's a real simple exercise for him.
Where is this August 16th meeting going to be?
Say again?
Do you know where the August 16th meeting is?
Right next door.
Oh, and it's really good. You don't think there'll be as many people that will?
Come early. Get a seat.
Might not be a bad thought to have a bigger room.
I'll look and see if this Pleasant Street's available. I think there's a reason I didn't try it.
Yeah.
It's hard to know. You think?
Yeah.
There's a good amount of people.
Yes. Well,
listen, I thought that would be, to be
honest.
Oh, is that
cool.
Right?
Yeah, I don't know. I didn't
just
count.
More.
Mm.
It's still summer vacation.
Yeah, it's summertime. It's kind of,
for some people.
My guess was last night would be busier than next week.
Yeah. More people are going on vacation.
No, just interest in the topic.
Mm. What do you think?
We've seen a lot of interest in tax policy topic on the selectman side.
Hmm.
Certain segment.
you know, once an override is called for and a number is out there, the interest will be very high.
Yes.
But joining a discussion in which it's, is it, do we do this much or this much?
Yeah.
I don't know. The school committee, I don't think, saw all that much attendance during the summer at theirs. Yeah, so I don't know. I really don't.
My only, and this is, I guess, sort of a personal comment, but when reading through this, and my first impression is, I get it, right? I sit through these meetings. I understand the impacts. I understand how the budget works. There's no hook here. Like, this is a political. Unfortunately, it's a political issue, right? Whether you like it or not, and the back of the napkin approach that you talked about when they did it last time had some, I'll call it meat to it, right? Something that people could get, sink their teeth into, hold on to.
See, I don't know if I'd say that. If what was dire was what was going to be cut, if not.
Yeah.
That's what it was.
Yeah.
It was
30
down.
Teachers, it was 20, it was
big. That's
the other piece.
I think 4 out of the 4 million was to avoid cuts, I would say, generally. Maybe not quite 3.5 out of the 4.5.
But to be clear, to be clear, if you look at, you know, Bob's predictions, and I think the school committees or the school departments, if it doesn't happen, there are, I don't know what the number is, but it's, I think it's 20s or more, isn't it, in terms of people?
On
the
school side.
The school side.
Yes.
I
think
school.
Maybe 30. It's a very significant chop.
That's unfortunate, but I feel like that's
right.
That's what people will need to know.
Right.
Right.
That's it.
Right.
I agree. It's like that's the.
What's really difficult to know, and I say this to the selectmen in a memo next week, is to me there's two wild cards on the town side. One is, what is the right amount of public safety personnel to have in this world? I don't know anymore. I really don't. And the other is, to what degree is the town interested in taking care of the elderly population? Right now we're well above average, and we're staffed slightly above average.
Well above average in what?
In elder human services.
Okay.
Do you want to improve that? Do we want to match the growth in the demographic? Do we want to get rid of it entirely? I don't know.
But the demographic is shifting rapidly.
It's going up fast, and we're going to need that.
But then there's a philosophical discussion of, well, you know, are there suitable nonprofit agencies that can step in and fill that gap and not have to be a town expense?
Right.
I think what the selectman vote yesterday shows is that there's certainly a desire to have town government.
The community has certainly said that.
Right, we did it with tax policy.
Yeah.
As one piece, and then there's the staffing piece as well.
Right, so when you talk about that, what kind of programs are you talking about? What cost? Examples?
Who knows?
Okay.
Really?
That's why I don't know. I don't know.
You know.
What is that?
What's not well known, certainly was clear last night, and in some emails I got today. People don't understand the dire plight of current seniors in town. You remember when Jane Burns came in and talked to you guys?
That was probably the most compelling briefing I've gotten since I've been a selectman in terms of
she's our
their day
human health services halftime person.
What their staff does on a day to day, what was really good about it is that she kind of told stories about
That's because I do.
Yeah.
You know, just kind of the like a mythic person, you know.
And it was a real person.
No, it was, but I mean, didn't, you know,
yes,
confidentiality is sort of, like just, there are people just living in isolation here in town with absolutely no support systems at all.
Mm-hmm.
And they don't ask. That's the thing, they don't come and ask for help. They don't go to the counter and bitch.
No, they don't. Occasionally they wander down to the end of the hall and, you know, their plight is obvious. We have staff at all levels, from department heads to clerks, that reach into their own wallet and go down to the grocery store and take care of them. That's the current facts on the ground in Reading. The community doesn't know that. Maybe it doesn't want to know that. I don't know. What is town government's responsibility there? It's a hard question.
It is a hard question. Whether that's a role,
it's a question. We have a nurse advocate. Very few communities have that.
We could probably use another.
We probably could, but how can we evaluate the effectiveness of something like that? It's, you can't measure it. You know, these are the kinds of things we have to struggle with, and no increases really to this is in this override. I shouldn't say none. There's a little bit of room called community, it's called boards and committees or something, 25 or 50 or 75,000 different pieces. But that's the kind of thing that I would hope through a 3.5% operating budget, every year we have an opportunity to do something. You know, if we manage our money properly and we take care of things, and Barry's right that things work out a little better, well then we can add another nurse or whatever it is you need. I don't like the idea, and I had a discussion with one of the school committee members, you don't just ask for the things you need once every 10 years. You gotta handle them. You gotta handle most of them. And all of a sudden when you just can't, then every 10 years you gotta say, look, I just need some help here. But you gotta have an operating budget process that allows you to expand. You don't spend all the money you can on just the stuff you already have.
Because priorities will change, needs will
absolutely
change.
Absolutely.
You know, you'll have to respond to things that you don't.
Okay, but sometimes you hope when you're putting something in, something's coming.
Well, what the town does that maybe the schools can't do, or that they certainly don't do, is put in a cost for a given year, like we're going to spend $50,000 to buy some computer stuff. Next year, we're not obligated to do that again. Now maybe we hire a computer person, or we hire another police officer. So we have a fair amount of costs that are flexible, I guess I'd say. I don't know the schools well enough to know how practical that is, but it would seem to be that there could be some of that. There must be, but again, I don't know. But if you don't build that kind of budgeting mentality in, you will never build in the flexibility to deal with things as they change. And you can't go running back to taxpayers anytime you need something new. It's just not gonna work.
But the reality is that both sides of government have been doing exactly that. That
right.
Priorities have changed, the requirements have changed, and you are defunding certain things to take care of the
right.
things you have to get. And to your point, though, at some level, you know, you can't do that anymore. Things fall out.
But we added a school resource officer as part of the budget process.
Right.
And that's what you should be able to do. And both the town and schools agreed it was a priority. It came in off the top. They added some social support for students. Same deal. That should happen. And we should be able to continue to have that. And I just want to make sure the community understands that we don't know everything now, but we'll handle it. Unless it's just something unbelievably outrageous, like we need to double our police officer staff. But we'll handle all the things we can normally predict. Because if they don't have that confidence, you know, and if they say, you had a $4 million list, we were able to only do two, we've got to be able to say, don't worry, we'll take care of it. And that's the discussion the school committee had at their last meeting before they voted, was how much is the right amount to ask in addition? How much should we just deal with ourselves?
Well, they have to, everybody has to be prepared to answer that question, because the addition could be zero.
Right.
People could vote no, in which case
right.
everybody has to be prepared to deal with the amount of money that we're able to spend.
Yeah. Yeah, and I'll say broadly from my discussions with John that the town is probably 1 year behind the schools in real agony. We still have some non-personnel cuts we could make because we've designed it that way. He's run out, very broadly. I don't usually like to speak for him, but that he's made that clear in a lot of ways. In our second year, we'll be exactly where he is. We'll be talking about 15 employees or whatever it is. Now it's less.
And they sort of tapped out the reserve.
And then if an override fails, you guys are going to have a large responsibility on you as how much do you want to spend out of free cash? How much pain do you want to see? That's an impossible question right now. And you may well have to answer that question without knowing high school litigation. In fact, I would predict that you won't know. I don't know what you do. Again, right now, if you use no free cash, we have to cut $3 million out of the budget.
Yeah, you know, the assumptions, I'll go through the packet in more detail. So was there any assumption?
Yes, $1 million. $1 million a year for 8 years.
So that's in there somewhere.
Yeah, it's in the model. It didn't show up on the packet.
So this is like over the next 8 years, you're still assuming there's $1 million.
Yeah.
Come back to state aid just for a sec.
Mm-hmm.
What's the actual bin? Is bin kind of two or under?
Is it 0.8?
The trouble is, not the trouble, we got 150,000 more than we thought we were getting as of April town meeting that we have to adjust in November. So the actual percent is higher, I don't know what it is. It's been in the 2% area, I will say.
Right.
The reason I like the 2.5 is we know the 2.5, it's a 2.5% over, 2.5%, you know, so that's sort of like why I like that number.
Yeah, I could change that, I'm just, I'm gonna have to change something on the cost side, so that all that thing doesn't change 7 million instead of 6. But, you know, you see the power of compounding over time.
Oh, yeah.
It is awesome. And so you don't want to make a fool of yourself by assuming something that's so outrageous that it looks ridiculous. I mean, health insurance 8% a year is unbelievable. When you cost that out in year 8.
Absolutely, so you go down, what percentage do you have to go down to make up for that half a percent of CD?
It's almost 1-for-1. There's like 13 million in state aid and 10 million in health insurance or something like that. So it's close.
So it's from the half percent.
Yeah. But the thing I learned, if I hadn't already known it, is, you know, sort of to Barry's point, you don't even know what's going to happen tomorrow. It's a point to try to predict 8 years. And when you do that, you know, the sensitivity is huge that you're wrong. We know we're wrong. That's the only thing we know is we're wrong. But to which direction, to how much?
I mean, it really comes down to, you know, if we explain it the right way, it becomes a question of trust. You know, you can't expect us to tell you what we're going to spend money on in fiscal 23.
Right.
But you have to trust us that we're asking enough money and we'll go through the budget process transparently every year to get to the point where we hope we don't have to ask you for another 8 years.
And that's the thing, that this stuff all says, if things go not that great, because that's what we've assumed, this should still last you for 8 years, no matter what. If things go a little bit better, it's going to last you for longer, 10 years, 12 years, 15 years, who knows? But to me, the right way to approach this, which is not the way we did it last time, and not the way most communities do, is what's worst case? I want to promise you that we're not going to come back in 8 years, based on everything we know today. And this does that. Most communities don't deep. Here's the 4 million we need. Here's what we're going to spend it on. We'll see what happens in the future.
Well, you ran that slide in the listening sessions, which is basically our peer communities. How many towns? How many towns around us who, since the last time we asked for an override, asked for an override?
Yeah,
and a lot of them multiple times.
Everyone has asked. Stoneham has not had one pass, but everyone has asked.
And some of them asked multiple times.
And that's, we could change and ask for less and last more often. That's the other option. I don't think Reading wants that, but, you know, one of the school committee members at the last meeting said, I think we should have one of these every 3 years. An override. I was like, I don't think so.
But in a lot of ways, I mean, you know, we've done a really good job of having a really transparent budget process throughout the years. I mean, you know, it's ad nauseum. But here's one argument that I would make, in that ways in which we have not been transparent, and I'm not saying this in a devious type of way, is that we've been so averse to going to the town and asking for money.
Yeah.
We look at it as sort of a badge of shame that we have to go and ask for more money. That in fact, what we've done is that we've unintendedly hidden the true cost of running the town government. You know, when somebody leaves and now you have somebody doing one person doing one and a half jobs, still making 7% less than the average person in our peer communities. You know, yes, to the average consumer of town services, town government is running fine. What they don't see is sort of, you know, behind the curtain. And behind the curtain is that, you know, we've hidden the cost of running. You know, and in fact, maybe what we should have done is 4 years ago, 5 years ago, ask for the override, and it wouldn't have been as big a number.
Yeah.
Right? And I think that that's important to let people know, is that, you know, we've done such a good job that we've delayed asking for money for so long, is why this number is higher than it has to be. And now we're saying it's gonna last, you know, no less than 8 years. And that didn't happen the last time.
But is it higher than it has to be?
Higher than it would have been if we had
Right, that's that, and I think that's the whole point, is that it's not higher than it has to be.
Right.
It's what we need,
right.
And that's the whole
thing. But people look at it and say, oh my God, you're asking for, not realizing that, well, if we had come to you 4 years ago when maybe Tewksbury would have, or any other town, you know, it wouldn't have been 8 million, maybe it was 4.
Right.
Right.
Well, it wouldn't have been that different,
well,
but it could have been a million less.
Right.
I mean, again, 660,000 a year.
And the Sandy check, I thought was going to be more significantly different than what we asked for 13 years ago. That's,
no.
It's not bad.
It's not bad.
I mean, some people talk
and
about
again,
doubling every 7 years.
Actually, as a percentage of the budget, it's lower.
And recall that the town against its peer communities is $750 to $800 on the average household below
that's
the peers.
That's an important slide.
So
that
this override brings you either to the average or slightly above the average, depending on what the number is.
Yeah,
and we're not coming back.
Yep. And again, that's meant to last for 8 years, means you're going to slip down below again because others are going to ask from
mm-hmm.
time to time.
Mm-hmm.
So, in that sense, it's not terrible. I mean, you're still running an efficient government school.
And the world has changed. I mean, I think that's the other thing you got to keep in balance.
Yeah.
You can't kind of, you can't go backward and presume that the world hasn't changed. It's not, doesn't work that way. You know, we've got issues that we didn't used to have. You have opioid issues, you have policing issues, you have a lot of different things. You know, it'd be lovely to go back and reduce costs, but it's not available. You can't do that.
Yeah, and to me the simplest soundbite is we're asking you for Prop 3, not 2.5. That's the simplest thing, and it's the truth. That's all it is.
Although, as you mentioned, I think before, the 3.5% rate as compared to the 3.4 in a $9 million override is awfully close.
Yes.
And in the concern with the Prop 3 notion is that Prop 3 doesn't get you what we're talking about.
Not this much.
Well,
get you to the 6.
Yeah, right.
But it doesn't get you.
Doesn't get you. Well,
yeah, so Prop 3.5 gets you the
gets
full
you.
Right. Right.
Somewhere in between. But it's not order of magnitude Prop 5 or Prop 10 that you're asking for.
Right. Agreed.
It's really not that different over a long period of time. I think that's the way it becomes much more digestible than a big number.
Mm-hmm.
And the chart you put in here, too, just sort of like, okay, it's big in the first year, but it's also big, you know.
Yeah.
Yeah. I think that will make it look not so bad.
You know, I think the town has generally done a good job at getting a lot of information, being very transparent. I agree with you that we have not, I'll say, complained enough. Certainly on the town side, I know that's true, because we discussed that internally from time to time. Is complaining being honest? Yes. We don't like to complain.
I think the other side that needs to get flushed out, and particularly for us as a group, is if the town decides not to do it, where are we? What are we faced with? What are we going to have to deal with?
You're faced with, if we are trying to get a 3.5% budget, we have a $2.65 million budget deficit, or maybe $3 million. We'll see, somewhere in the 2.5 to 3.
And the challenge is a lot of work between now and having a vote, because that's what people are going to need to see.
Yeah, and next week you will hear from the school committee that a 3.5% budget for next year is not acceptable. Well, that's probably a strong term, but it doesn't accomplish it. They probably have to cut. It doesn't accomplish what they want.
And I think the other thing that I'm sort of on the other side of it, on the more positive side, saying, hey, there was no financial mismanagement. Why? That's not how we got here, because I feel like, and I know that, and I can say that, like, with 100% certainty. It's just
the fact that it lasted 13 years.
And that our bond rating is as high as it is, and you know, like, that there's been no mismanagement. So it's not like we've gotten here because of issues. We're getting here because of everything else. I feel like that's the two sides to it that have to be.
Well, and the other thing is that the work we've done over the last 10 years can be done by anyone in the future. So that stuff didn't exist the last time an override happened. It was like, here's what we need, here's why, let's move on.
Right,
now there's a very complex tracking mechanism for anyone to every year follow this stuff internally and figure out, when do we need to start worrying, instead of, oh my gosh, all of a sudden we're $2 million out of balance in February. So, you know, the town's financial practice has evolved a great deal, and there should be no surprises unless the surprise is genuinely, you know, a nation. already telling you that you're gonna need to start talking about an override in FY24, based on all this. As each year goes by, you'll know whether it gets shorter or longer. I don't think it'll get shorter unless something unusual happens, and it certainly hopefully lengthens. But when the last override happened, whatever was said was not a financial statement. It was a, oh, that's sure to last for a while, you know, 7 or 8 years. No one did any analysis, just a guess. But I also know that 15, 13 years worth of creativity cannot be repeated in the next 13. Not to the same degree. It just can't. It doesn't exist, I don't think. Maybe I'm not creative enough.
A lot of creativity has gone into this, and how things have lasted for as long as they have.
Yeah.
And this is such a quantum leap ahead in terms of the amount of work you guys have done over the last few months in particular, trying to organize this in a fashion that's digestible.
We've actually talked about self-insuring and hiring physicians. Just so you know, we're exploring all the options.
Can
all
town employees get in?
No.
Do you have a doctor at work?
I'm not surprised.
Yeah.
Yeah, honestly.
Mm-hmm.
Wait.
I have a doctor's appointment this week.
At work?
At work.
At
work.
How many people in your room?
It's only 1,000 people.
Well, that's a lot of people.
It is, but it isn't. It's a doctor
yeah.
and nurse and that part-time administrator.
Yeah, no, we've talked about that, believe it or not, here. It sounds
well,
crazy,
now
but...
working now instead of having a day.
Exactly.
You go downstairs as opposed to take the time off. It's like,
yeah.
like a walking...
I was like eager to go to work for my doctor's appointment because it would take longer to get my appointment for my doctor.
Yeah, so it seems like a bad idea for society, but there's a practical aspect to it. So really, we are pretty open-minded in terms of thinking about and discuss it on the way. Always welcome new ideas.
So, any other comments for the evening?
Thank you, by the way, for having for Walter.
Oh,
you are always welcome. I mean, all folks are welcome. No, great.
No, you didn't want to be.
Put your jacket
in. Yeah, that's good.
So, it would be great to have a number of us attending the meeting next week. The folks know if they're able to.
I would like to be there. I probably will be there. I just have to double check schedule-wise. And
okay. Why don't we post?
Why don't we do that?
Okay.
For next week, and let's see how many folks.
I'll look into other rooms just in case.
Okay. Just get next door right now. We fill it pretty quickly, but let's see what we can do. Depends.
We have that
AC, let use a longer meeting.
Yeah. Turn the heat on.
Exactly. Actually, the AC was on big time.
No,
last night.
Was like,
it could have been much worse.
That was more than
minutes.
Really?
No,
I was getting
hot. Well, yeah.
Before we go over minutes, just looking at practicalities for a minute. So we have a financial forum on September 1st. Between now and then, we have a regular meeting the day before.
I won't be able to make it.
Yeah, I'm still be on vacation.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
The 31st? We're talking on the 1st. I can't make the 31st.
You cannot make the 31st.
Right.
Yeah. So we're kind of at the forum.
The idea of the 31st was just to give you a preview of the 1st. You may or may not find that useful. I right now I couldn't give you a preview.
Yeah, no, I understand. You can't move it sooner.
No.
I would, maybe I'll send out a poll to see if we can actually make that day. I'd love to kind of see the preview.
I haven't even talked to John about it yet, so.
Okay.
And it's a lot of stuff you'll have seen from both of us just.
Right,
just organize
and set for the next day. Yeah, so my suggestion is let's leave it on the calendar for right now. We'll send a poll out, see
what
the
regular meeting at that
the
time.
Regular on the 31st. It sounds like before it's just time to be practical.
The forum won't be easy.
Sorry, the 31st, our regular meeting, we'll
yep.
keep on the calendar.
Yes.
The 1st will be a forum, that's on the calendar as well.
But perhaps moving that 31st to the week earlier?
Well,
no.
The issue is not, we won't really have.
So I feel like we do have a lot to digest.
Right.
To
yeah.
Again, the purpose of the 1st is just to have this discussion we had tonight with the community effectively, plus add the schools.
But I think having us as comfortable, all of us as comfortable as possible for that meeting is very helpful. Because because there'll be plenty of questions.
Right, we say we all.
Yeah, and what we haven't discussed is whether, for instance, you know, senior tax relief is a topic for September 1st or not.
It should be second, I think, if it's on the agenda.
I don't know. I mean, it has nothing directly to do with the need for an override, nor does the high school litigation.
I don't think it should come into financial forum discussion.
I think you'll find that the selectmen are very split on that question.
Oh.
And I'm myself.
I know, because
you know, you always, you know, to the point earlier, more information is always better than less. But why are we here? You know,
right.
Nothing that happens on the 1st is going to impact the senior tax relief discussion. It may impact the town meeting in September as to what is discussed, how it's discussed, you know, for the
mm-hmm.
override. And that's the point of
yeah.
September 1st.
And that's the one that the senior tax relief is actually the one item that town
Right.
In reality, you just can't talk about them all in one night.
That's the other
thing.
So we talked at different points about like a pre-town meeting, the notion of inviting town meeting members to presentations.
That would be September 1st.
But then the topics would change again. And if it's focused on town meeting members, then you might be able to argue, well, it should be focused on senior tax relief.
Yeah.
And I agree with Paul, you can't do them both in one night.
Well, town meeting is also so divided on whether they should hear the discussion of an override in town meeting or not at all.
I don't know that town meeting is really divided on that.
Oh, they are, believe me.
I think certain individuals are very strong about it.
It's
I don't think we know how town meeting feels.
Well, that's my point, though.
Yeah.
There is a core group, including people you would not expect, who thinks this is not a town meeting's business. An override. Town meeting has no role.
They don't want to talk about it.
Well, I mean, not a formal voting role, but you know, if you're a quote-unquote representative member of your community, you want to at least minimally be maximally informed. So when you're cutting your lawn and your neighbor comes up and says, you know, what the hell, you can reasonably speak to it.
That's my job.
Right.
Can we put that on horse guard?
And I'll tell you, the other thing that strikes me is again, certain people, even last night, were talking about, oh, I didn't know about this. Oh, I haven't heard about this. And, and we're all, I think, you know, screaming with megaphones as best we can to get people aware of what's happening and to be able to come. But
the fact that there is now an election that is in the public as a certainty should mean people ought to
I think it's another
start
piece.
Yeah.
Minutes we're going to postpone until the 31st. Okay, and so our next agenda we'll have a clean draft of the.
I'll send it up before that.
Great, we can look at that. Okay, so we'll post for next week. I think we're there. If anybody else have other business? Welcome, Eric. You're right into it. Day one.
Can you folks look at the liaison assignments and check your contact info and update it if you need to? Yeah, I don't mean
Eric, so we need your little bit of info. Phone number.
You can just shoot me an email, Eric.
Oh, sure. Yep. I'll do it.
All right.
Motion to adjourn.
Do we have a second?
Second.
Folks, we have a motion to adjourn on the floor and a second. All those in favor? Opposed? Thank you.